Welcome to Grace Bible Church Pearlside Online. Jesus is the light that gives life to the world. Pastor Norman Nakanishi sheds light on how Christ enters our lives to defeat guilt, shame, and condemnation so that we can be a light to the world around us.
In the Gospel of John, chapter 8, we find a riveting story of religious leaders and residents of a town watching as Jesus encounters a woman brought before him who has been caught in the actual act of adultery. She is caught by religious leaders, and to catch a woman in the act tells me these are pretty weird religious leaders. You get my drift? But here's the story as it unfolds, a visual from the Bible and the History Channel on John chapter 8 and its opening.
Commands us to stone such a woman. What do you say?
It's a trap.
I'll give my stone to the first man who tells me that he has never sinned.
Wait, dear. Thank you.
Go and sin no more.
That's who Jesus is. And Jewish law of the day, rabbinical law, the law of religious leaders, dictates that she would have been and should have been pummeled by a gang stoning. But Jesus approaches her and gives her, in the midst of shame, guilt, and condemnation, the light of mercy and grace in the midst of darkness, with everybody looking on. And Jesus, she finds, is a light in darkness. And that's why many of us are here. And God calls all of us who've experienced that light to take it to others. Now, here's the story unfolds here in the 12th verse of the Gospel of John. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world." So following this episode, what we don't see, we read. "Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And the Pharisees challenged him. They challenged him. "Here you are appearing as your own witness, and your testimony is not valid." And Jesus answered, "Even if I testify on my own behalf, my testimony is valid, for I know where I came from and where I am going. But you have no idea where I come from or where I am going." Because see, they didn't know who Jesus was. "You judge by human standards, but I pass judgment on no one." How many of you have ever had difficulty forgiving yourself for what you have said or done? That's all of us, isn't it? That's human standard. But heaven's standard, through the light of the gospel of Christ, does not condemn us. That through Jesus and his shed blood and his finished work on the cross, that if we come to him and we receive him, just like the woman caught in adultery, that she allowed the touch of God to come upon her. It's a whole different story. I've been at this for 42 years as a Christ follower, as a minister for 30. I've had talks with adulterers. I've had talks in situations in my office or in private homes where husbands and wives admit to their affairs. And the guilt and the darkness in those rooms are very difficult until you bring the gospel and the light and say, here's who Jesus is. He doesn't expect you to clean up your act. He doesn't expect you to put your own shame aside. What he desires is for you to see not only who he is, but what he's done, as we'll remember in communion today. That when he went to the cross and he shed his blood, he did that for you. To cover your sin, to cleanse you from it, and the force of its residue of guilt, shame, and condemnation. All he waits is for you to receive him and the gift of who he is into your heart. I've sat with murderers. In fact, in our church, we have people, you and I, who have contained in our lives sins of all kinds. I've sat with rapists. Over the years, I've had conversations, and they cannot forgive themselves. Almost to a person, they say, you don't understand, I feel unworthy. And I said, that's why Jesus died for you. You could never feel worthy in yourself. You can never, ever get rid of the guilt and the shame. But I said, Jesus, that's why he went to the cross. And if you will believe in him and receive him into your heart, the Spirit of God will enter your life, and the ability to shed the darkness of your past will give way to Jesus, light of the world. He will light up your world, your inner world. Some of those people, all those conversations over the last nearly 20 years are in our church today, and they've been a light to others, and you know who you are. I remember being in a room where for the first time, a man confessed to his wife that he had fathered a child without her knowing 25 years prior. And he confessed for the first time that he had been unfaithful to her. He had a very, very, very difficult time admitting that. And the woman looked at him. And by the grace of God, I swear Christ entered that room. She broke down. He broke down. There was no judgment, no condemnation. And she looked at him, grabbed his hand, and said, I've known. And I want you to know, God forgives you, and I forgive you. And we all cried. And since that time, there's been a marvelous transformation. I look back at that. I look back at the times I sat with this man who was in federal prison for 30 years, talking with him. I cannot forgive myself. And I said, God never expects us to forgive ourselves or to clean ourselves up. He has given his son. All we need to do is receive him, and the Spirit of God by his grace will set you free. And some of us here this morning, that's what you need to hear, because sometimes we just say, well, I have this little thing in my life or this corner or this habit. The Lord knows that. He just wants you to know that he knows already, and he wants you to keep that heart open to him, because he's not going to stone you. He died for you. In fact, he's been stoned already for you. But understand, as the grace of God comes, interesting with this woman, Jesus touches her, embraces her, but then he tells her, go and sin no more. There is a responsibility that now she has because Jesus has touched her. And now she is to follow him. It's the only way she can sin no more. And God knows that we will fail and fall. But if we keep open to him and asking him for his strength, and we receive the cleansing of his shed blood, there is no condemnation. So there's the sovereign touch of God on this woman. But then he tells her, you have a responsibility. I've touched you now, and you have the grace, you and I, to live responsibly. When we fall, we go to Christ. He doesn't condemn us. He forgives us. He forgives us. We move on. We get up, and we say, God, help me in the area of our weakness. Help me in the area of my failure. How many of you do that? I do that all the time. I do that every day. I never feel condemned or judged. I never feel I'm trying to trump it up. God knows it's supposed to be a yoked walk with him. And when we start beating ourselves up, it's usually because we've moved away from the Lord and we're living in our own strength. And when I look at that episode, I go, Jesus, I need you. I never want to walk separate from you. Never, ever do I want to do that. When we follow Jesus, we have his light. Man, how many of you want the light of God in your life? See, look at this 12th verse again. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And this following, this relationship with Jesus keeps us connected to him. His grace flows in our lives like a river. The great apostle Paul put it this way in Ephesians chapter 2, because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. Wow. It is by grace, or God's unmerited favor, unearned, undeserved favor, you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace. There's that word again, unmerited favor. Expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus, for it is by grace, third time Paul mentions it in these three verses, it is by grace, his unmerited favor, undeserved honor, you have been saved through faith. Grace comes into our life through a decision of faith. God works with our human will. He doesn't force his will upon our will. We are not autobahns or robots. Through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works or self-effort, that no one can boast. We don't ask for gifts. How many of you ask for gifts? It takes the fun out of it. Can you give me for Christmas this year this? No, gifts are free. They are freely given. Most of the times, I hear this every year, somebody receives something, you go, oh my goodness, such a big gift, and I only gave them candy. What are we doing? We're measuring performance. I mean, look, I'm going to tell you right now. If you give me a car and I gave you candy, I don't feel bad about that at all. Because I'm free. I'm going, you know what? God just ordained your generosity. It's his grace. Now, if I then try to go back and go, oh my God, I better add to the candy, that's works. See, and a lot of us think that I got to get more points with God. God gave me his son. Oh my God, I better do stuff for him. I better earn my worthiness for, no. Jesus says, sit down. Just sit down. I want you to revel in my free gift. But there's some stuff that I have for you to do. That's my will for you. That therefore, because it's my will for you, I'm going to give you the grace to accomplish in this life. It's not just receiving Jesus and sitting down. Freely you have received, what the scriptures say? Freely give. And so when we become Christ followers, guess what happens? We possess the light of his mercy and grace. We come into the light through faith. And then what? Jesus makes us the light of the world and a light to the world. Watch this. In the Beatitudes, which is Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, the constitution of the kingdom of God. If you look at the seminal essence of how we are to live as Christians, by his grace, Christ followers, this is it. You are the light of the world. This is a passage out of it. All three chapters, but this excerpt, as it fits our message today, Jesus tells this crew of disciples, seekers, sinners, religious leaders. I mean, it's a motley crew. And look what he tells them. He says, you are the light of the world. They probably looked at each other and went, not you. Not you. I am none of us. Hey, Jesus, what are you saying? We are the light of the world. We don't even know who we are. He says, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill, which is where our building will be. It's on a hill. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others. Interestingly, in other words, light shines unless you intentionally hide it. Let your light, you already have light, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify yourself. No, glorify your Father in heaven. Next Sunday, the world will be watching about 100 players, if they all get to play on a football field in the most watched event in history. One of the three most watched events. Every television set, even people who don't understand American football, will be watching for the $4 million commercials. And they're going to be watching the halftime. Who's in the halftime show this year? Bruno, our own Bruno, Roosevelt High School. And his assistant, by the way, comes to our church. But that's another story. Okay, now, because you're not going to pay attention to the rest of the message. Okay? Yeah, he comes to our church. All right. In fact, I Vibered him in London by accident. How many know what Viber is? Hey, I feel pretty cool then. I Vibered him by accident. And he goes, who's this? I said, Norman Nakanishi. He goes, Pastor Norman. I'm with Bruno Mars in London. And I'll be honest with you, I did not know who Bruno Mars was at that time. Now I'm trying to be cool. Oh, Bruno Mars, okay, thank you, because I didn't know he was doing the halftime show. So everybody will be watching Bruno and the commercials, and if they have time, the football game. A football game broke out in the middle of the circus called the Super Bowl. The world will be watching. The quarterback for the Seattle Seahawks, his name is Russell Wilson. He's like 24 years old, 25. Young guy, loves Jesus, Christ follower, a believer. They said he couldn't play in the NFL because he's too short. He's 5'10 and a half. They exaggerated it to 5'11 and a quarter. He's 5'10 and a half. Ask him. He's not supposed to be playing NFL football, much less quarterbacking the NFC champions in the Super Bowl. Except Jesus had other ideas. And he tweets this. Take a look. Let's post that tweet. My mind's got to get over BVD because I think of things when I see BVD. For we are God. We are God. I shouldn't have said that. No filter. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. The 10th verse following the verses that we just read that says we are saved by grace alone. And a lot of people in movements today sometimes only like the first part because that's comfortable. But he's called all of us to good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. And what Russell Wilson says is his good work right now is football. So let's roll the clip. Mark Driscoll, Mars Hill Church in Seattle, interviewing five Seahawks. I especially like this clip because it's got an Asian guy in it.
Well, you know, I'm Russell Wilson. I was born in Richmond, Virginia. Actually, I was born in Cincinnati, Ohio, but I lived in Richmond my whole life, ever since like one or two. I got saved, though, when I was about 14 years old, and that's when my life started changing. I used to be a bad kid, you know, shockingly.
What kind of bad kid? Like, like long snapper bad kid, or how
yeah,
bad?
Yeah, like Gresh. I used to be terrible. No, I'm kidding. No, I just used to beat up people. I used to bite people. I used to do just bite stupid people. Stuff. Yeah, I used to
man,
do
that. Sounds like a D lineman.
It's a mean
yeah.
D. But, you know, I think that, that's kind of when my life started changing.
Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't be where I am today without Jesus. You know, Jesus is my all. He's my everything. I'm not perfect by any means. You know, I try to do the things the right way. I try to live righteous. But I'm a constant, you know, work in progress. And we all are, you know, and nobody's perfect. And that's the amazing thing about Jesus is, you know, he takes you for who you are, you know. And so, you know, for me, you know, it's just giving him all the glory.
How important is it for you to have someone bigger than you, somebody to look up to, somebody to worship, somebody to live for, somebody to not make it all about Russell?
Well, you know, we talk about playing for an audience of one. You know, audience of one truly is, you know, playing for the Lord, playing for Jesus Christ. And, you know, every time I step out, people always ask me, Russell, do you ever get nervous for games or do you ever, like, worry or anything like that? No, not at all. You know, when I step out in the field, God's put me on that field for a reason in front of 80,000 people for a reason. And I truly believe that through my play, hopefully, that I can change people's lives.
Yeah. And I would say this, too. You've done a good job, man. I mean, the mood in the city is, here's a man who works hard, he cares deeply, he produces results. There's a lot of boys waking up tomorrow putting on a Russell Wilson jersey going to school, you know? Anything you'd tell those boys that look up to you and put your jersey on and are rooting for you?
Well, you know, I think for me, you know, everybody's parents are different. Everybody comes up in a different lifestyle. You know, for me, you know, I was blessed enough to have parents that believed in the Lord. And I was blessed enough to have parents that worked extremely hard and were always motivating. But if you don't have those people in your life too, it doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter if you're 8 years old, 5 years old, 15 years old, or 25 years old, or 45 years old. Jesus is still real. Jesus is still alive. And so I just pray that those kids live with an open heart. Try to learn as much as they can about the Lord and try to find somebody to look up to. And the person I look up to ultimately is Jesus Christ. You know, that's where I am where I am today.
Yeah, he bit people. Okay, so the great, okay, yeah, I missed that. Okay, he bit people. That's interesting. A lot of vampire shows out there today, zombie shows. I don't know if he was channeling some of that when he was younger. But there's the two things I take away from this interview. Number one, he plays for the audience of one, so he knows. Number two, he plays to glorify him. Number three, he's not nervous when he goes out there, because if you talk to Russell and you read about him, he constantly is praying through the game, God, I need your grace, I need your power. So he's not afraid of what we call performance failure, because he knows it's not about him. That's why a guy in his second year of pro ball is in the Super Bowl. I would like to suggest to you, Jesus trusts him, that he won't be about himself, as Pastor Mark asked him. And then he says, I want my performance, I want my play to change lives. He wants to be a light, not unto himself, but to the world. I would suggest to you that their field is the football field. Your field is where you work, where you serve, where you go to school, where your kids go to school. That you would let the light shine. You know what I mean? The grace of God is not just for us to feel good about ourselves and to revel in a personal experience, a mystical, vertical experience. No, let the light of God's grace shine. Because Russell Wilson lives every play. He's praying on every play. God, I need your grace, your power, so that I can glorify you. Winning and losing is great. Now, how many of you are going to root, therefore, for the Seattle Seahawks? Okay, that's hard. This is very hard, I know. But Denver fans, take heart. Peyton Manning is also a born-again Christian. He's not vocal like Russell. He's not vocal like Kurt Warner. He's not vocal. But out of his book, co-authored with his father, Archie, Peyton and Archie Manning call Manning. And if you ever get to see the new SEC story on ESPN, Manning and Manning, you see the tremendous family that they have. I cried when I watched that show. You can watch ESPN and cry. Trust me, 2 hours. What it should be like between fathers and sons, simply because their heavenly father is the model. Okay, they're playing it this week because the Super Bowl is coming up. ESPN, the extra spiritual powerful network. Yeah. All the women are going, move on, move on. Let me read you. What many fans of Manning and the NFL may not be aware of is Manning's strong Christian faith. He has intentionally chosen to speak more by his action or deeds first than by his words. He says, I rank these priorities as main: faith, family, education, then football. He says, football can never be higher than fourth. My faith has been number one since I was 13 years old, and he's now 36 or 37. And heard from the pulpit on a Sunday morning in New Orleans a simple question: if you died today, are you 100% sure you'd go to heaven? He said, my heart was pounding, and the minister invited those who would like that assurance through Jesus Christ to raise their hands as I did. And I did, he said. And then he invited us to come forward to take a stand, and my heart really started pounding. And from where we sat, it looked like a mile to the front. But I got up and I did it. I committed my life to Christ. And that faith has been most important to me ever since. Peyton writes, he says, Christians also make mistakes just as non-Christians do. My faith does not make me perfect, but it makes me forgiven and provides me the assurance I look for. He said, I pray every night. Sometimes I pray long. I pray about a lot of things and a lot of people, but I'm no better than anybody else in God's sight. I consider myself fortunate to be able to go to him for guidance. I believe, too, that the life is much better and freer when you're committed to God in that way, and I find that being with others whose faith is the same has made me stronger. He says, my dad says it can take 20 years to make a reputation and 5 minutes to ruin it, especially when you're on the public stage, right? I want my reputation to be able to make it through whatever five-minute crisis I run into, and I'm a lot more comfortable knowing where my help comes from. Peyton Manning. Now, how many of you are going to root for the Denver Broncos? See? I'm not biased. I'm presenting both sides of the doctrine of the Super Bowl. I think more importantly than who wins is the glory that God will get as the whole world watches, as the believers on both teams try to express his light and his glory. Can I hear an amen? And sometimes that happens when you lose. When Jesus was on the cross, they thought the Super Bowl was lost. But then there was a resurrection. And sometimes we win through losing, and sometimes we win through winning. The main thing is, who are we serving? And the quarterback is the most strategic position on a team. All things being equal or close to being equal, we all know, those of you that are sports fans or football junkies, most teams, the most important position you start with is the quarterback. And here are two Christ-following, grace-driven QBs. I think that's just fascinating. I think God sets stuff up like this. And here's the thing you need to know. I never watch the Super Bowl live. As restaurants are empty, and Faye and I usually go on a date day. We get to sit where we want. We get extremely great service. And then I DVR the game. And I come home and watch the whole Super Bowl and skip all those ridiculous $4 million commercials, because that's what they've risen up to, 30 seconds for $4 million. I skip all of that. I can watch the entire Super Bowl. I skip the halftime show. I know that's sacrilegious to you. I can't stand the halftime show. It was Elton John 1 year, Paul McCartney. I says, these guys are old. Because I'm old, but these guys are older. Okay, we got a younger. Now, I think they may be Bruno, I don't know, okay? I skip the halftime show and I watch the whole game. I DVR, and I recommend people DVR so they can go to church. Now, the game is at 1:25, I know. However, there are other games during the season. I talk with pastors. They go, every time the 49ers play, the Seahawks play, church is empty. I said, you need to preach the gospel of DVR. So people go to church. So, oh, I'm going to come nighttime, Pastor. I'm going to come nighttime, Pastor. My night crew tells me they never show up. They're probably OD'd from all the food. Listen, humor aside, their field is the football field in which they are to be a light to the world by the light of Christ that lives in them. You know, nothing's more endearing than to hold the hand of people who feel like they're done, that God won't bless them or forgive them for what they've done. Remember now, I've held the hands of murderers. And I'm just going to say this. This woman was an adulterer, so I'm going to say it. I've walked people through those kinds of things. Not always does it work, because sometimes forgiveness doesn't happen. But I am stunned and marvel at when the Lord comes into the room. Our job is to dispense the gospel. The Lord's job is to bring the results. And I can tell you, there's no greater high than to see people come to Christ or get restored to Christ when in the middle of their darkest moment, the light of God's mercy and grace comes. For me, that is just an astounding, astounding moment. And therefore, we close this series. Jesus is the light of the world. But then he turns around and he says, you are the light of the world. As we close this series and we come to communion, can we make a fresh resolution to let the grace of God and the light of God not be hid under a bushel? Several years ago, I talked to New York attorneys, artists, and tax accountants and writers, most of whom were very affluent. And I shared this with them. And I remember I said this before, that the tax accountant was really happy. He'd gotten to his $1 million condo. He says, God is really blessing me. And I sat there and I said, that's tremendous. And then he said to me, but you know, this stuff about letting the light shine and you know, getting the gospel out of my life and telling my friends at work, and that you say that's my field, but you don't understand. It might hurt my reputation if I talk too much about Jesus. And I said, no, I said, to the contrary. If you honor him, he will honor you. You have the light of God's grace in you. You need to let it out. Here's what scripture says. You're an attorney, right? Here's the scriptures. His human logic got in the way. Really, what happened is he was his own idol. And I said, look, if you don't open your mouth about where your success comes from, then you're glorifying yourself. That's why Peyton Manning and Russell Wilson make a point now to say, they know the whole world will be watching. And they don't want the world to be watching them. They want the world to see Jesus and know who Jesus is. And so we conclude our series with communion. Will you let the world know who Jesus is through the light of the gospel in your life? One guy said amen. I love you, Chris. Let me ask that question again. Well, let's start with easy questions. How many of you believe Seattle will win the Super Bowl? Okay. How many of you believe Denver will win the Super Bowl? Yeah. We're trying to get Tanavasa to come back next week. He played for Denver, has 2 Super Bowl rings. Okay. So pray that he make it and bring his Super Bowl rings, wear his orange crushed jersey and all that. Okay, we're hoping for that. How many of you now, you believe Denver will win? Okay. Seattle will win? Okay. Now, how many of you believe we should let the light of the gospel shine through our lives? That's better. That's better. Start with the easy questions and work from there. Father, what a great church. What a wonderful people. They come every week to hear your word. They wrestle with portions of it. But Lord, we know you want us to live all of it, but never in our own strength. Like the Peyton Manning and Russell Wilsons, who pray throughout the game, God, I need you. And it's about you. We pray the same for ourselves. We remember who you are and what you did on the cross. Wow, amazing. We're so grateful.